Hi everyone, Lloyd Rieber here again with my first presentation of the course. Throughout the course, I'll provide several presentations of key or fundamental statistical ideas. Knowing these ideas is very important for making sense of the statistical computations we'll be performing. In this presentation, I'll introduce you to the key ideas to get you ready for the first Excel spreadsheet example. Okay, let's get started.
Okay, well, let me start with one of my favorite quotes. There are lies, damn lies, and statistics. I'm not really sure who gets credit for this quote, but it's an interesting one, isn't it? I've always felt it didn't quite do justice to statistics because I believe that only people can lie. Now, they can lie with statistics, but the statistics themselves really had nothing to do with it. So let's explore this idea a little bit here. And the first example is bowling. And I think I gave you the heads up about this, that our first Excel spreadsheet example is going to be in the context of bowling. So if somebody said to you that they have a bowling average of 175, you begin to make certain assumptions. For example, you assume that that average is based on a collection of scores actually based on bowling at a bowling alley and not perhaps on a Wii PlayStation or some other video game version of bowling. You also expect, of course, that they followed the rules of bowling as they gathered that data. So if their foot crossed the line, that would be a foul, and you would expect their scores to reflect that. Now, you might wonder, did they count all of their scores? So, for example, somebody who has a bowling average of 175 usually only counts the scores when they're bowling as part of the games in a league, and that you don't count the games that are part of practice. So I think these are all, again, examples of where do the statistics come from and what are the assumptions under which that data was collected. And you know, sometimes, especially in education research, we would like to collect data that frankly isn't available to us. So sometimes we have to make some tough choices, and you will often hear of people saying that they had a convenience sampling. But you have to be kind of careful about just how convenient something is if that data really will be meaningful. And it reminds me of an old joke here of a husband who is looking for a shirt button in the kitchen, and his wife says, "What are you doing?" And he says, "Well, I'm looking for a button that fell off my shirt in the bedroom." And she says, "Well, why are you looking for it in the kitchen?" "Well," he says, "you know, the light is better in here." So sometimes it can be very convenient to gather certain kinds of data, but again, it won't necessarily be that meaningful, if at all. And I apologize for this slide being so text-heavy. I really try to avoid text-heavy slides, but I think this is a good one. And the slide actually comes from ideas in a book that we use in one of our classes at the University of Georgia. The book is Leedy and Ormerod's Practical Research, Planning and Design. And it talks about the idea of measurement as a tool of research and the importance of measurement as limiting the data. Because you see, there's far more data than you could ever possibly be able to deal with or collect. So you have to make some decisions on how you're going to limit the data. And the data are going to be limited by the measurement construct, the thing you're trying to measure, learning or motivation, engagement, the instrument capability. An online survey, for example, as compared to a paper survey, have very different capabilities. And finally, the amount of raw information that you are prepared to deal with as a researcher. So again, you have to make some very difficult decisions, but certainly all research, you're going to have to limit the data. And to give you an example of this, it's really much more of a metaphor of the different kinds of data you will be able to collect depending on what options you choose. Here's a satellite photo of a place in the United States. And I wonder if you can figure out where this place is. Now, at this high altitude, obviously I can't make out very many details at all, really none about the actual place in terms of, you know, the buildings and so forth. But I do get some sense of the geography, and I think you can see those rivers that are quite prominent. And I see it looks like there are three rivers there, two coming together to form a third as I go from right to left. and I see that triangle right at the rivers, where the rivers meet. Well, it turns out this is my hometown of Pittsburgh, and taken from this viewpoint, you can get a very interesting sense of the geography. But you don't get any sense of the communities that we have in Pittsburgh. Now, if I come down, let's just say I'm in this helicopter and I come down about halfway closer to the earth, I might get this view. And this view, I start to see much more information about neighborhoods, and I see the street layouts, and I get some sense of the green areas. I see that baseball field down there. I get some sense, perhaps, of the groupings of people. Now, if I come down to close to street level, we get a much better idea of what that neighborhood looks like, and the size of the houses, the size of the yards. And indeed, this is actually my neighborhood. This is the street where I grew up in Pittsburgh. Now, what's really interesting, by the way, as I go back up in my helicopter, I stay centered on my street. So this is, again, right above my street. And this imagery as well is taken where my street is the focal point of the image. To kind of wrap that up, here's another little metaphor for you. We'll see if you can figure this out based on my imagery there of the firefighters on the left holding that fire hose and that teacup on the right. So isolating meaningful data when conducting most research studies is like what? Well, the metaphor is, you know, there's all the amount of data that's possible to collect might be that fire hose, but the data that I'm able to collect and make some sense out of would be like the teacup's worth of the water coming out of the fire hose. So let's now talk about a very important set of concepts in statistical circles called the four scales of measurement, which is going to refer to, when I collect data, what kind of data is it? And depending on the scale of measurement of that data, it will tell me what kinds of manipulations or calculations I'm allowed to perform on it. And there are four scales of measurement: nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. So let's briefly consider these in turn here. So first is nominal. The nominal scale actually kind of gives you an idea of what it means, because nominal means name. You're giving a number as a name for something in the data. So for example, I could give somebody a survey that says, what is your favorite color? And in order to code that, I might say, well, let's just say blue is 1, red is 2, yellow is 3, green is 4, and purple is 5. So you can imagine giving a survey like that. But again, the numbers don't really mean that 4, that green, is twice as much as red. It just means that it's a convenience that 4 is the name. But some people might do the exact wrong thing by actually saying, well, why not just add it up and say, oh, the average favorite color was 1.6. So Lloyd says this result makes absolutely no sense because the data are nominal. Therefore, we can't average them. I'm not allowed to do that mathematical calculation on them. And again, to use a Pittsburgh example, two of my favorite Steelers, Heinz Ward on the right retired, but there we have Heinz and Troy Polamalu, and you know, Heinz, his number when he was playing was 86 and Troy's was 43. That's their name on the field. It does not mean that Heinz was twice as good as Troy. Okay, let's consider the ordinal scale of measurement. And really, ordinal means the order of things, or a ranking. And so we're going to compare various pieces of data in terms of one being greater or higher than another. So that's the idea of rank order data. To give you a sense of this, here are some of the presidential contenders in the 2008 presidential race. Again, only on the Democratic side. So some of these people you know probably very well, and what their futures held, some you might be struggling to know who they actually were. So if I were to give you a survey of some sort to say, please rank the current candidates in your order of preference, well, I could put them in order, but it doesn't mean that my first place person necessarily is twice as preferred as the second place. The only thing that matters here is the order of the data. So let's compare that to the interval scale of measurement. So again, somewhat of a text-heavy slide because these are the key ideas. So let's go through them, then we'll come up with a few memorable examples. So an interval scale of measurement has equal amounts of measurement. So from point 1 to 2 or 2 to 3, that does actually have some meaning, that there is considered an equal amount from point to point. But the zero point has been established arbitrarily, and that's going to be something I'm going to come back to later. So the zero itself doesn't really mean zero in the sense of nothing. And the example that I will come to, and might as well give it to you now, is the idea of temperature, okay? Zero on one scale, like Fahrenheit, means one thing, but on a Celsius scale, it means something else. So by having an interval scale, though, I am allowed to determine the mean, the standard deviation, and things like the product moment correlation. You're allowed to conduct inferential statistical analyses on interval scales of measurement. Now finally, let's compare all that to the ratio scale of measurement. And it's also important to know that as you go up from nominal to ordinal to interval, now to ratio, each of those latter scales of measurement take on the characteristics, they include the characteristics of what came before. And in fact, the ratio scale, the key idea here is that there is an absolute zero point. So it's, again, very similar to interval with the important difference that it does have an absolute zero point. And one is allowed to conduct virtually any inferential statistical analysis. So what I'd like to leave you with, though, because I think most people get confused, they struggle with what's the difference between interval and ratio scales of measurement. I'll leave you with the example here that a measurement of heat or temperature, we use a thermometer, and if you think to yourself, it really does not make sense to say that 40 degrees is twice as hot as 20 degrees because, no, that's an interval that I can look at 20 to 30, 30 to 40, that's an equal amount, but I can't be making ratio comparisons that this is twice as much as that. Whereas a ratio scale, I think the most common one would be length. If I measure a board, and this board is 5 feet and that board is 10 feet, then I can make the ratio comparison that the second board is twice as long as the first board because zero length has meaning, but it does not have meaning when it comes to temperature. So I hope you walk away from this with that important distinction. If not, please study this, whether it be in a textbook that you may have or Google this to make sure that you understand the difference. So here's a nice chart that lets you know when it's okay to compute these different kinds of calculations. And as you can see, under nominal, there really is only one type of computation I can do, and that would be frequency distribution or, counting something up, for example. So being able to count your colors, which color was the most preferred, for example, so the most of something. Whereas with ordinal, I can do a little bit more with that. I can certainly count up as well, so the preferred candidates, but I can also compute things like median and percentiles. And you can see for interval, I can do just about every kind of calculation except those that involve ratios, whereas a ratio scale of measurement, I can do all of these things. And as we'll see throughout this course, there are two important types of statistics. Measures of central tendency, measures of variability. And in this particular module, we're only going to be concerned with measures of central tendency. In the next module, when we get into descriptive statistics, we're going to explore both of these in more detail. So there are three measures of central tendency. We have the mean, which we are all familiar with. It is the average of a set of numbers. We have median, which I think we're also somewhat familiar with, if only from the news, because many statistics are often reported using the median, such as the home sale prices. The median is simply if you take a set of numbers and arrange them in descending order, the median would be the number at the midpoint, although sometimes you would have to interpolate to find that number. The mode is simply the number in the set of scores that has the greatest frequency. You might say it's the most popular number. The interesting thing is, given a normal distribution, these are all the same number. So here you have a graphical representation of the normal distribution, the classic bell curve. And if you look at the apex of the curve and kind of follow that down, trace it down to the x-axis, That's going to identify the mean, median, and the mode. So a normal distribution is symmetrical, and when you have a normal distribution, the mean, median, and mode are all the same number or the same value. But that is not the case when you have a skewed distribution. So in this graphic, and I apologize, it's a little fuzzy, we have, of course, the normal distribution again in the middle, but you see on the left and the right two skewed distributions. They are not symmetrical. The left, negatively skewed. You can see the numbers are rather bunched up on the right-hand side and the tail going toward the left. And we call it negatively skewed because we follow the tail going in the negative direction. Positively skewed is the mirror opposite. You see again the numbers bunch more toward the left and the tail going to the right. Now notice in the two skewed distributions the fact that the mean, median, and mode do not represent the same value. The mode, of course, is again can be traced down from the tallest part of the curve, given that it is the has the highest frequency. But notice that mean on the negatively skewed is far to the left. On the positively skewed, we see the mean is far to the right. And somewhere in the middle is going to be the median. Now this is very important, and I actually have another video to share with you where we demystify the normal distribution to make sure we really understand where it comes from and how it is generated. So I do recommend that you watch that video and make sure that you understand the normal distribution very, very well. The reason is that the statistics that we're going to be calculating all depend on or are based on the assumption that your distributions are normally distributed. And I think one classic example I think helps understand why I would use median instead of mean, and really what a skewed distribution means. So this is an exaggeration, but it drives the point home pretty well. So you often hear median income. So imagine a neighborhood of 1,000 people. And in that neighborhood, there are 999 extremely poor people. Let's just say they all have an average income of maybe $1,000 a year. But also in that neighborhood, you have one billionaire, all right, who earns $1 billion a year. Well, if I take up all 1,000 scores, their incomes, divide by 1,000, you're going to get a data point that says, wow, that's a pretty rich neighborhood. I need to go live there. Well, no, it's obviously a very poor neighborhood. The best measure of the central tendency, what number best captures or represents the entire group, is not going to be the mean. Instead, the median is going to do a much better job of saying, well, if you take the middle income of all those incomes, that's going to be a much better representation of the income of that entire neighborhood. Same thing with median price of homes. You often have neighborhoods where you have several homes that might be quite exquisite or just over the top in terms of what they're worth, and most of the other homes, or the far majority of the other homes, are not nearly with the same value. So median price is a better measure of value of the home in that neighborhood. Okay, well, we're going to stop there. In the first Excel spreadsheet example, all we're going to do is compute some averages to get some sense of how that works. And I'm actually using it as a starting point because I know all of you understand what a average or mean is. It'll be a good example of following me in Excel in a video tutorial and then seeing how we're going to submit that for evaluation. All right, well, this concludes this presentation.